Hey, I didn't realize this looks dark, but you're not gonna have to look at me much of the time. Let's do some more contrapuntal expansions. That's right. Yeah, that was supposed to come a little bit earlier. Why more contrapuntal expansions? Number one. So we learned four basic categories of contrapuntal expansion: the chordal leap, the neighbor, the passing expansion, and the arpeggiation, quote unquote. And I just remind you here, remember, this just means you're leaping around in the bass, usually all in one direction, like all down. Not the spelling out of any particular chord. So the arpeggiation expansion doesn't arpeggiate anything in particular. It's just jumping around in the bass. All the other ones are moving. Well, the chordal leaps jump, the neighbors move stepwise, and the passing moves stepwise. So in the previous video, and that previous video has I'd say crucial background information on this, so make sure you have watched that before you see the sequel, which is this one. We did this using only a limited set of triads and their inversions. And this was limited to just one chord, 1-6, 5-5-6, 7-6, and a little 4-6 in there. So now we're going to level up to more contrapuntal expansions. Level 2, using 5-7 and 7-7 chords. Dun, dun, dun. Notice here the whole circle. We're not really doing half diminished seventh chord. So if we were in major, your 7-7, or is this 7-7 would be half diminished. We're just going to consider these are all in minor. I mean, you can do the same things in major, but they sound normal in minor, whereas they sound a little bit less common in major. And then we're not just using those two chords, but we're using them in all their inversions. The root position, 6-5, that's first inversion. 4-3, which is second inversion, and 4-2, which is third inversion. Now, just to update our chord vocabulary, before we were looking at 1 and 1-6, 4 and 4-6, what? 5 and 5-6, 4-6, and then 7-6. And now we're adding these 5-7 and all its inversions, and then 7-7, 7-6-5, 7-4-3, 7-4-2, and then a little bit of 7 half diminished, but I don't think that even enters into the chapter. Okay, this is a screen from the last presentation. And I just want to point out that we're using the same principles to, I guess, to assess the stability of different chords. What determines whether a chord is strong, i.e., structural, versus weak ornamental. And the Roman numeral still matters. Like one chord's still stronger than five, five stronger than two and four, and two and four stronger than six and three. And then seven is the weakest, the most unstable. So, but before we had, in terms of inversions, we had root position, first inversion, second inversion. Now we have third inversion. And third inversion and second inversion are both going to be considered equally unstable. So third isn't any less stable than second inversion. They're both unstable. They're both dissonances. Why is that? We remember that the 6-4 chord has a fourth above the bass. Well, the third inversion of a seventh chord has a second above the bass. So especially if you measure against the bass. And then all seventh chords have some sort of dissonant interval in them. So they are always going to be less stable than triads. Okay, and then duration, metric placement, that's still the same. Chords on strong beats are usually bigger, more important than chords on weak beats. Chords with longer durations, longer are more important than chords with shorter durations. So common substitutions for the contrapuntal expansions. This is another slide from last time, but I'm just reminding you because now it becomes relevant. So anything that we had five in before, we could sub in 5-7. If we had 5-6 before, we could sub in 5-6-5, right? That's the same as this is five chord, five triad in first inversion. This is 5-7th chord in first inversion. We could have a 7 chord in root position, and we could have a 7-7 in root position. And then later, we come back and we say, hey, why is that the case? Well, these all have scale degree 5 in the base. These have scale degree 7 in the base. These have scale degree 2 in the base, 7-6, 7-6-5, 5-6-4, 5-4-3. These have scale degree 4 in the base, 5-4-2 and 7-4-3, and we'll look at that a little bit more in detail. So what principles are at work in making these acceptable substitutes? You remember this from the last video. Well, what scale degrees are in the base of each? Scale degrees in the base, scale degree 5 for those guys, scale degree 7 for those guys, scale degree 2, and scale degree 4. So since these are contrapuntal expansion, we are talking about the baseline, contrapuntal expansions, talking about the baseline as if it's a melody. That's why it does make sense to think of how the bass note is functioning melodically, right? So if it's on, if the bass is scale degree 2, it's probably passing between scale degree 1 and scale degree 3. If the bass is on scale degree 7, it's the leading tone, and it's probably moving to scale degree 1 by a neighbor or an incomplete neighbor. If it's scale degree 4, it's probably the seventh of a 5 chord or something like it for the 7 chord, and it's going to resolve down to scale degree 3. So that's what happens when we think about the bass melodically. Ooh, this table looks big. I tried to make this as simple as possible, and so you might want to just come refer back to it a couple times, copy it down yourself. All the stuff in this column are all the contrapuntal expansions we learned last time, and then this is what we're adding this time. And by the way, this looks much more complex than it is. It's not as complex. So with triads, when we had quarterleaps, we had 1 and 1-6. You can go between those two, go between 5 and 5-6. Now we're just going to say, hey, all the different dumb 5-7 inversions, you could move between those. And all the different inversions of the 7-7, you can move between those. Okay. So it's not really that complex. With neighbors, we can go 1-5-6-1, which we know. Now, we're going to learn we can go 1-5-6-5-1, right? This is just the same thing. It's a 5-6 chord with a 7th on it. It's a 5-7 in first inversion. Just like this is a 5 triad in first inversion. And then same thing. We can go 1-7-7-1. Notice for the leading tone 7ths, I'm always putting these in minor keys. But these could work in either major or minor. And then another neighbor thing, I think we see one example where we have this, but a 1-6 going to 5-4-2 going to 1-6. One thing I do want you to learn, and you should maybe write this down in your margin notes right now, is that 5-4-2 always goes to 1-6. You should remember that. And Leitz doesn't talk about this all that much, just in passing, but it's something to remember also, which is 7-4-3. Right, third inversion, 7-7 chord. I know it's hard to, it's a lot of complexity, but that chord functions pretty much identically to 5-4-2. So if you ever want to know how does 7-4-3 function, it functions like 5-4-2. And if you say, whoa, how does 5-4-2 function? You know, because I just told you and you just wrote it down, check your notes. It says 5-4-2 always goes to 1-6. So 7-4-3 also goes to 1-6. Okay, incomplete neighbors, we saw one example of this, a 1-6 chord to a 5-6 to a 1, and then you could just make that 5-6 a 5-6-5. You could do a different thing, which is to go 1-5-4-2 and then 1-6, right? 5-4-2 always goes to 1-6, just like there. You could do this, and you could do this, the substitutions there for leading tone sevenths. Double neighbors. We'll see an example of this. You go 1-5-4-3, 5-6-5-1. The scale degrees in the bass are scale degree 1, scale degree, see if you can guess, what scale degree is in the bass of a 5-4-3, of a second inversion 5-7 chord? The answer is it's scale degree 2. What scale degree is in the bass of a 5-6-5? Scale degree 7, right? So this is scale degree 1, 2, 7, 1, or do, re, or if we were in minor, it would be La, Ti, Si, La. Woo. Okay, passing structures. The main one we saw is 1-7-6-1-6. And instead of 7-6, you can just put in a 5-4-3. So it's a 5-7 chord that has scale degree 2 in the bass, just like this. And 765 is going to sub in for 543. That's a rule you'll learn. So you could do exactly this thing, just with a 77 instead of a 57. And we learned this one last time, and there's no new version of this, but 5 passing from 5 to 56 through 46. And a new one that we get, we'll see an evaded cadence, a 5 chord going through 542 to 16. And you often think if you're on a 5 chord and it feels like the dominant, it feels like it's going to be a cadence going to 1. But then you weaken the chord by bringing in the 7th, its 7th in the bass, and then it has to resolve to 1-6. So that's called an evaded cadence. It's not a real cadence. Okay, and lastly, we learned these two arpeggiations from last week, and we don't have any new versions of those. So that's how you read this table. This has sort of like the collected knowledge of everything that's in this presentation. I know this is a lot of stuff, but it's probably good to see it all in one place. And you can obviously come refer back to this. Maybe just take a screenshot. Okay, moving on. I wanted to review some figured bass stuff with you. So we did triad stuff last week. 5-3, 6-3, 6-4, all C major triad. Now we're just going to do... put sevenths on it, C, E, G, B, right? Same notes, just with C on top. Again, same notes. Same notes. B's on the bottom. So, then we practiced a little bit figuring out this 5-3, 6-3, 6-4. What does it mean? You're always measuring from the bass, so the E is a third above the C. And the G is a fifth above the C, right? This E has a third above it, which is G, and a sixth above it. This G has a sixth and a fourth above it, so it has a fourth, which is C, and a sixth, which is E. So if we said we don't know what the figures are for these chords, we could just start with C and go, oh, there's a third, there's a fifth, and there is a seventh, so 7-5-3. Above this E, there's a third, a fifth, and a sixth, so 6-5-3. Above this G, there's a third, a fourth, and a sixth, so 6-4-3. And above this B, there's a second, a fourth, and a sixth, so 6-4-2. Now, we also know that we get to abbreviate them. So this was the unabbreviated form. Let's see. Woo! That was loud. This is the semi-abbreviated, semi-unabbreviated. I kept all these things, but I put in parentheses the ones we get to get rid of. So we get to get rid of both the 5 and the 3. Get to get rid of the 3 here. In this case, we get to get rid of the 5 and the 3 and the 3 and here the 6 and the 6. Now, there is a pattern to this. I'm going to tell you two different ways to think about it. So the first one you could think about is just in this one, just always assume that there's a fifth and the third above the bass. And if there isn't, you have to tell the person. So if I just show you a C, you assume that there's a fifth and a third above it, and it gives you that C major chord. If I just give you an E, you would assume there's a fifth and a third, but in this case, you don't want a fifth and a third, you want a third and a sixth and a third. So you say, aha, it's not a fifth, it's a sixth. And in this one, you see a G, you assume it's going to be a fifth and a third, but this tells you, oh no, it's not a third, it's a fourth, right? And it's not a fifth, it's a sixth. So that's how you could think of those, like why you get those abbreviations. With this one, the easy way of thinking about it is you get 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, if you ignore this 4. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, or 4, 2. And sometimes this is really abbreviated, just 2. But I was trying to figure out at some point why that is. And the reason seems to be this, that you always want to give the root and the seventh. So... you always want to specify that, and everything else you can assume that the people know. So in this chord, it's like, assume you're seeing the note C by itself, but you want these notes. So you assume, I guess the same thing as before, like you assume that the 5 and the 3rd, but let's just do it this way. So the C is there, and you need to specify the B, which is the 7th. So you need the root and the seventh of the chord specified. In this case, the E is there. You need to specify both the B and the C. So that is the fifth and the sixth. Fifth and sixth. In this case, a G is given, and you need to specify the B and the C. So that's 4 and 3. And then in this case, the B is given. You need to specify just the root, which is 2. And then we also do specify 4. But if you did 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. Okay, just a little bit of review for you. If that was like, it didn't make any sense, I don't know. You could rewind and listen again, or you could probably ignore it. I'm just trying to help you get these things to make sense in your mind. Are you ready? This is going to be a loud sound. Thanks. Abbreviated, so we could just get rid of this stuff in parentheses now. All right, now let's explore what happens when we have accidentals. So this time I'm doing C minor for triads and C minor seventh chords, just to practice doing accidentals. So unabbreviated, I kept all the, this is instead of saying just nothing, it says 5-3. And I'm putting a flat next to the third, a flat next to the sixth here. Right, it's always measured above the bass. So, in this case I get a flat third and a flat seventh. In this case I have a flat fifth. Notice that there's a flat in the bass note, but the bass note is given. I don't have to have anything there. So it's just a flat five. In this case the bass is G, I have a flat third and a flat sixth. And where do the flats come in? They come in relative to the key signature. If the key signature just had three flats in it, like it would normally for C minor, then we wouldn't have any accidentals down here. Okay, and last one, B flats in the bass. We need a second, we need a flat fourth and a sixth to produce that chord, the C minor minor seventh. Uh-oh, that's the wrong order. Well, let's just go with it. So in the abbreviated form, you can see I got rid of the three here. I can just put flat, because flat by itself or sharp by itself or natural by itself means the third. So this means flat three. Here I'm just like covering up that third because we don't need to specify it. If it's a 6-3 chord, we don't need any extra accidentals. We can just write six. Here you need a flat on the six. And you still have to specify the four. Here, you need a flat for the 3, and you need to say flat 7, but you could just get rid of the 5. So you might see flat 7 flat as your figure for this chord, if you're given the C. The 6 flat 5, you do have to specify, the flat on the 5. You can omit the 3. Okay, this one is, normally we would call this a 4-3 chord, but if we do have to specify that the sixth is also flat, we have to say flat 6, 4-3, and if the 3 is flat, flat. So, a weird looking figure. Imagine this, you see G on the page, you see this figure, and you know this 6-4 flat means six flat 6, 4, flat 3. So you just write in a G and a third above, and then you flat it, and then a fourth above, and then a sixth above the G, and flat it. That's how you do it. And then you're like, oh, that's a C minor minor seventh chord. Okay, and above is B flat. You can get rid of the six, but you still have to say flat 4 and 2. All right, I know you're wondering, like, but could you show us with sharps? Because this is super fascinating. Okay. I'm going to go through this faster. You could just pause and work on it on your own if you have any questions. But I did the same thing. I just did C sharp minor, so I could use sharps. C sharp minor, minor seventh. So, I mean, we end up doing different notes, right? In the last chord, last page, we had C, E flat, G. Now we're sharping these two and leaving the E. So, I mean, these figures are all going to be different. This is the unabbreviated form, and I'm just using sharps. I want to show you the abbreviated form because, so in this case, you're given a C sharp and you want the person to play an E and a G sharp above it. So you don't have to say anything about the E. You assume they know it's a 5-3, but you have to say the fifth is sharped. You don't usually put a slash through the 5, but you could. You definitely do put a slash through the 6, and the sharp by itself means a third. So E is given, you want a raised third and a raised sixth. Just remember that slash means sharp. If with 4, you don't usually see slashes or sharps. You could see any of those things, but you often just see the plus sign. So, I mean, I wanted to show you that all these mean the same thing. You could have a sharp in front of the numeral, you could have a slash through it, or you could have a plus after it. Just wanted to give you some variety. But you sometimes see a slash through the 2, slash through the 6. Okay, great. So let's listen to this example. We're remembering that we can do chordal leap contrapuntal expansions, and then this is a kind of example of chordal leap, and we'll end up calling it something different in a bit, but this is just to create some continuity with the last lecture. We know in the past we can go between 1 and 1/6, and we can go between 5 and 5/6. Now we're just also saying, you can go through any of the different inversions of 5/7 and any of the different inversions of 7/7. Now, I do have to say something about that. If you were listening for the bass line, I do not hear this particular bass line in that. What I hear is, well, they're in a different key. Interesting. Okay. Well, anyway, so let me play you what is written here. So, we're going to later call this a double neighbor, but for now we could just notice that you can go between 5/4/3 and 5/6/5 and then back to 1 again, and that's sort of like a little chordal leap within the 5 chord. Okay. Here is another example. This one is very cool. Mozart Symphony in E flat. Okay, Kerschel number 132, the Andante. This little passage comes in the, it's like the second half of the form, and the whole first half is in E flat, and then I guess it tonicizes B flat, but then the second half starts just all of a sudden on this very strange sounding chord. So give it a listen. So good. Okay, I'm going to play it for you again. I'm going to start you off in E flat major just so you can hear. That's the key. And you know what? The first half probably ends in B flat. And then it begins on this chord. A. Okay, so it's going to begin there. And let's give it one more listen. What you're seeing is that there, you know, you have a scalar run down in the bass. And that is mirrored with the opposite movement in the upper voice, same exact rhythm. Okay, so. And Leitz does a little diagram over here that shows you that. And he's also reducing out the notes that he's thinking are less important. So he's including. So he's saying that this whole passage is basically like prolonging or expanding a fully diminished chord, a B fully diminished. B, D, F, A flat. And B, D, F, A flat. So that would be this guy moving chordal leaps through different inversions of this chord with some passing tones in between. Okay, so neighbor tones. We spent some time talking about these in the last lecture. And just to remind you that there's complete neighbors, you know, like normal, which we abbreviate N, and then there's also incomplete and double neighbors now. So last one, we paid most attention to this 1-5-6-1, so we could play that. Melody, you have a chordal leap, and now what he's just going to show is, like, it's not that big a deal in letter B there if we go. You can think of that thing as a passing tone, or you can think of it as the seventh of the chord, because you can make the attack right on the downbeat of the chord, so in letter C. So all of those just count as neighboring structures. And so what we see now is we could have 1-5-6-5-1 instead of 1-5-6-1. We could do the same with 7-7, and there's not an example of that, but I'll play it. I'll just do it in C minor. So I'm going to play like letter C, but instead of this G there, I'm going to put an A flat. And then, but it'll be in C minor. There you go. 1-6-5-4-2. 1-6. We don't have an example of that, but I'm going to make it up. I'm going to start here. I'm going to go 1-6-5-4-2-1-6. So let's do that. That's not right. Okay. So neighbor tone in the bass, you could expand 1-6 by just going briefly to 5-4-2 and then back to 1-6 again. Incomplete neighbors, the one that we just played, is actually an incomplete neighbor. 1-5-4-2-1-6. Yeah, so let me play this whole example. Forward. Remember this rule, 5-4-2 always goes to 1-6. So you're on 1, you jump into 5-4-2, and then 5-4-2 has to resolve to 1-6. That's always going to be, if you're just jumping into 5-4-2, it's going to resolve to 1-6 as an incomplete neighbor. 1-6-5-6-5-1. Yeah, you could do that. Or a lot of these you can do the reverse. So 1-5-6-5-1-6. And that in the same way that you could do that with a 5-6 instead of 5-6-5. It'll sound basically the same. And this example that Leitz gives you here, a 5 going to 5-6-5 going to 1. He has CS. Just think of that as CL, CS, chordal skip, chordal leap, same thing. That's why I crossed it out. Here he's making kind of a distinction by saying this 5 and this 5-6-5 go to, let's just not pay attention. Let's just call all these incomplete neighbors 5-6-5 going to 1 and 5-6-5 going to 1. I'll play these two examples for you. So. You could do the same thing with the 5-6, 5-6-5, and 1. And then we have double neighbor, which we actually saw in that last excerpt, and I think we come back to it maybe on the next screen, and that would sound roughly like. Do, re, ti, do. Just a way of expanding 1 through double neighbor. Okay, so it's not on this screen, but we'll see it eventually. Passing. We talked about some passing structures in the last class, and the main one to pay attention to was 1-7-6. 1-6. Here we're also learning that we can, instead of having 7-6, which has a scale degree 2 in the bass, we can have 5-4-3. Now those are almost the same chord. So let's think in, let's go ahead and do this key. This is going to be A minor. 7-6 in A minor. What is the leading tone of A minor? It's a G sharp. So G sharp diminished, G sharp B D. And then G sharp B D in first inversion, the B is in the bass. So a G sharp B D with B in the bass. Now let's think in still in A minor, let's spell a 5-4-3. So let's spell a 5-7 chord in A minor is E G sharp B D. The fifth is in the bass because it's 4-3 inversion. So G sharp B E G sharp B D with D in the bass. And this chord was G sharp B D. I think I said that wrong. This chord was G sharp B D with B in the bass. This chord was E G sharp B D with B in the bass. So it's the same chord, just this one also has an E in it. Okay. So and let's look at that and I'll show you and you can hear it. So 1-6, 5-4-3, and 1. And then in this loyer sonata, it's going to sound basically the same as that. Okay. So this is the simplification of what's going on here. And in this case, it's like basically identical. You're just leaving off the last chord. So this chord here that's B, E, G sharp, D, right? That's an E dominant chord with B in the bass. So it's an E dominant with the fifth in the bass. That's a 5-4-3 in the key of A minor. If I just get rid of the E, scratch that out. But now it's a 7-6 chord. So I'll play it as 1-6, 7-6, and 1. And that's going to function exactly the same and sound pretty much exactly the same as if I do include the E here. Okay, that's why they function the same. So that's why you're learning 7-6 is kind of the same thing as 5-4-3. Right, you're learning the passing structure. Okay, and then here we'll see 5-4-3 going leading upward, but it's the same idea. Notice this is the one case when the seventh of the chordal seventh, C, E, G, B flat, the B flat is allowed to go up. And he's pointing that out because you have these parallel tenths, parallel thirds, parallel tenths. And here, I believe we have Ian Bostridge singing it for us. Oh, yeah. I think we come to those later. I don't know when we're going to get to hear Ian Bostridge singing that, but we're going to get to this example at some point. So in the last lecture, we also learned if you want to pass from 5 to 5-6, you can go through 4-6. We're also learning this newish one where you can go from 5 down to 1-6 by passing through 5-4-2. 5-5-4-2, 1-6. Just like that. This one's passing. This one's also passing. Now Ian Bostridge, I believe. There's some introduction. Once he comes in singing is when you get to hear this. And it'll repeat.
Am Bach viel kleine Blumen stehen, aus hellblauen Augen sehen. Der Bach, der ist des Meeres Freund und hellblau liebt ins Auge scheint.
Okay, here is our 5-4-2 and 1-6. And really that 5-4-2 thing is just passing tone. But let's hear it.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to look at a little bit more detail at like voice leading and stuff for the 5-7 chord. As you know, there's two tendency tones in the 5-7 chord. You got one here, leading tone, scale degree 7, goes up. And you have the 7th of the chord, the F, which wants to go down. What is the interval from the F up to the B? That's an augmented 4th. Augmented 4ths usually resolve out, and that is what you see there. So let's hear this one. And he's noting here the 7th of the chord always descends by step. And the leading tone, if it's in an outer voice, has to go up. Now, though, he's going to show you that if leading tone, if it's in an inner voice, which it is here, is allowed to not resolve up. It's allowed to go down, and it'll sound just fine. Do it again. Seventh does have to go down. Kind of had that in an inner voice. The B going to G. Okay, so, and then these are the rules that Leitz states. I'm just going to go ahead and read it. There's no new voice leading rules for writing the inversions of 5-7, but remember these tenets of good part writing that have already been discussed. Move most, if not all, of the voices by step or common tone when you're leading to and from inversions of 5-7. This rule is actually new, even though he didn't say it. Use complete chords for inversions of 5-7. So if you have your 5-7 chord in root position, you can omit the fifth. If you're doing a 5-7 in inversions, 5-6-5, 5-4-3, 5-4-2, then you pretty much don't want to double anything. You want to try to get all four notes independently. So that is a new rule, in fact. Number three, place inversions of 5-7 on metrically unaccented beats so that they connect tonic triads, which usually tend to fall in strong beats. Okay, that's just a general rule, but it does mean that an inversion of 5-7 is weaker than a root position 5-7. Number four, resolve tendency tones. Scale degree 7, the leading tone, must ascend when it occurs in an outer voice, but it's allowed to fall to scale degree 5. In the tonic chord when it occurs in an inner voice. Scale degree 4, which is the 7th of 5-7, does have to descend to 3, except in that one unusual progression, 1-5-4-3-1-6. Let me do that again. Harmonizing the melody notes 3, 4, and 5. Okay, that's just, well, it's fine. Okay, moving on. Evaded cadence. This is something that comes up a lot, and then people often forget it. So maybe make note and try not to forget it, or just make a note that you're gonna forget this. Okay, so first example, we're just gonna see normal stuff that we saw in last chapter. So 1-6 chord. 7-6, 1-6, or just 1. So that was a little passing structure. And then a chordal leap to 1-6. And then 5. And we're assuming this is at a cadence. And above the bass, you have an octave going to a 7th. So your 5 chord becomes a 5-7, and the 7th resolves down, the leading tone resolves up. 5-1, perfect authentic cadence. I'm just going to play it one more time without talking. Or I'll try it. Okay. Now, same thing. Maybe I'll play this one first so you can hear it, and then we'll talk about it. So, In the first case, it was a perfect authentic cadence, 5-1 root position, right? And scale degree 7 moves by step to scale degree 1. In the second case, it's not a perfect authentic cadence, no PAC. You have root position 5 chord that resolves to root position, or to first inversion 1. So that is not perfect authentic cadence. And we really aren't going to consider this a cadence, because if you do 5 in root position, that's really a different sound than... Right, I'm even going to make the bass a little bit bigger. It's not over, it's got to keep going. The cadence again, and then I have root position at the end, and that's a real cadence. So evading cadences means like it's not a cadence. Okay, an evaded cadence, you can define it as 5-5-4-2 going to 1-6. I usually just define it in my head as 5-4-2 to 1-6. The 4-2, the 7th in the base of the chord, so 5 chord, that weakens the chord so much that it can't function as a cadence, a cadential 5 chord anymore. Here we go, Donizetti. Same thing we saw before, and we were talking about these two chords as being two different inversions of 5-7, and so it's kind of like a chordal leap. But this whole thing together with the bass notes, E, E, F sharp, D sharp, E. Has a double neighbor function in the bass. Eating a little pasta. So that might be a little bit of my kitty's outside. I don't even have a cat, but this is my cat friend. Let me just pause. All right, well, Kitty's not here yet. I mean, I opened the door. So I'll let you know if the cat comes in. All right. This is a little bit of deja vu because you remember this from the last presentation. And I told you you don't have to know anything about the Fenerali, and that's still true. But the Fenerali is so cool. So one, two, three, seven, one, two, three, seven. And it's accompanied by... It's the same thing in the bass. Anyway, it just so turns out. And there the chords are 1, 7, 6, 1, 6, 5, 6, 1 again. Just so turns out that Beethoven does the same thing. There's a little introduction, but when the big section comes, you'll hear it. Beethoven, third movement of the Fifth Symphony. So again, we have the whole that Fenarelli thing. In the lower voice, so 1, 2, 3, 7, 1. And, you know, ignore these things that are not in the box. We just need the notes that are in the box. But, okay, so in, and then the chords this time are a little bit different. 1, 5, 4, 3, 1, 6, 5, 6, 5, 1. Before we had 1, 7, 6, but we know that 7, 6 can sub in for 5, 4, 3. 1, 6, we had a 5, 6 before instead of 5, 6, 5. And now we have 1. And the difference is actually just like that G is held in the upper voice. Okay, so in the bass, 1, 2, 3, 1, 7, 1. And in the middle voice, it's, you know, it's hidden there, but the rest of them are there. And together. So you sometimes think, like, how does Beethoven come up with all of his ideas? This is just an idea that everybody uses all the time. So, I mean, it's not that he wasn't a very intelligent person, but, like, you could do this, too. You just sort of learn the... You're learning the things, the algorithms. And, of course, we have in there 1, 5, 4, 3, 1, 6, which is passing, and then an incomplete neighbor from 5, 6, 5. Back to 1. Mozart. Give this one a listen. It goes pretty fast. I told you. Okay. So, with this one, I'm just going to play it nice as though. So it starts with a kind of 1 chord, and then it goes to 5-4-3, right? Like a C dominant chord in second inversion. Notice the treble clef in the left hand. Going to a 1 chord, an F. Another C dominant, but this time the B flat is in the bass. And then F in first inversion. Now, Leitz is single out B flat, A, G, F, because it's the same as this bass line, G, F, B flat, A, but just that part goes with there and that part goes with there, which you'll see in just a second with color. But for now, assuming this is a 1, 5, 4, 3, 1, so this is a neighbor, upper neighbor, and then this is an incomplete neighbor, 5, 4, 2, always goes to 1, 6, and Mozart did it right. Good job, Mozart. Leitz incorrectly labels this as neighbor, but it's not, it's an incomplete neighbor, whereas this one is a neighbor. So, 2, 1, 4, 3. I'm going to play the excerpt again. Two, one, four, three. And that's echoed above with 4, 3. Just like the thing at the beginning is echoed in the melody up there. Okay. Now, so what we've done so far is we've reviewed the contrapuntal expansion that we talked about in the last chapter. And we applied them by thinking about the different inversions of 5-7. And now we're just going to do the same thing with the 7 fully diminished chord. And the 7 fully diminished chord, we're going to think of it mostly as just being like very similar to the 5-7 chord. And you will see that in a second. But let's first start with an example by Gluck. I can't remember Gluck's full name. Christoph Heinrich? No. Wow. Embarrassing. Okay. But give it a listen. This is from Orfeo, probably around 1750. Right around 1750. Orfeo, you probably know the story, but he has a girlfriend, maybe even a wife or a fiance. Her name is Eurydice. And she gets bitten by a snake and she dies. And that makes him sad. And because Orfeo has all these magical powers, and he's a very good musician, and his magical powers are musical powers, and he can like make the rocks and the trees and all the animals come and listen to his music, sort of like me with that little cat, except the cat. I'm apparently not doing as well as Orfeo could do. So Orfeo decides to go down to Hades and try to convince Pluto to give back Eurydice to him. So that's the story. Thou hast left him quite forsaken. Care and sorrow press upon him. Come then, come, set him free from distress. This is toward the very beginning. Oh, actually is the very first number in the first act. When Orfeo shows up and hears that Eurydice has been bitten by a snake and she's died. And this is the end of that piece. Awesome, right? So I think his name is Christoph Willibald Gluck. So we got a little five chord. We're in C minor. Little five chord at the very beginning, but we're going to kind of ignore that. Then you got a little thing that's marked P, but then a 1-6 for a while. Six, and then gonna be just a little thing marked N, neighbor, and then back to 1-6. So, where am I here? Right, and then 1-6 for a while, and then another neighbor thing, and then more 1-6. Thing marked neighbor, and then back to one, and then that's gonna happen again, and then back to 1-6, and then more neighbor for a little while in here, repeat of that same thing to 1-6, and then more N. Going to 1-6. Then this thing marked IN, B natural, F, A flat, D. Interesting. A 1. And then a little IN thing, and then cadential 6-4. Oh, which you guys don't know yet, but. Just means it's the big old five at the end. And then tonic. So across this whole thing, assuming all the things marked N and IN are just going to be reduced out, right? They're not structural. They are ornamental. That means we have tonic from the beginning. It's just, it's a 1-6, but still, I mean, that's it's 1-6 for long enough that it's tonic-y enough at the very end, dominant, and then tonic. So that's our phrase model, T, D, T. Everything else is just decorating the one chord. So let's look at what kind of decorations they are. That first one, F, D, A flat, B. So it's a B, D, F, A flat, a B fully diminished chord in second inversion. 7-4-3, I don't know if you remember this from one of the early slides, but 7-4-3 is going to be the same as 5-4-2. So 5-4-2, we're in the key of C. We would have a G dominant chord with F in the bass. So G, B, D, F. So if it was 5-4-2 in the key of C, it would be exactly this chord, except instead of A flat, we'd have G. And it sounds the same. So just like 5-4-2 resolves to 1-6, so the same as 7-4-3 resolves to 1-6. And I bet you every time we have a 7-4-3, except once, it's going to resolve to 1-6. So that's pretty interesting. Let's keep going on. The next one, you get 1-6 for a while, and then you get, hey, what's that? Oh, just another 7-4-3 that goes to 1-6. Then another 7-4-3. What chord is this? It's a D, F, A flat, B. So again, B, D, F, A flat, B fully diminished. The D is in the bass, so it's the third of the chord, B, D, F, A flat. So it's a 7-6-5. 7-6-5 is going to function in the same way as a 5-4-3. Why is that? It's almost the same chord, so let's pretend like this A flat is a G. Then we'd have G, B, D, with D in the bass, that would be a 5-4-3, but instead it's B, D, F, A flat, but still D is in the bass. So here's a 5-4-3, here's a 7-6-5, right? So they're gonna function in basically the same way. So 5-4-3 can go to 1-6, and 7-6-5 goes to 1-6. I'm sure that doesn't make too much sense right now, but it will probably make a little bit more sense in a couple slides. And then we repeat that again. This is the one where we keep repeating it. Still 7-6-5. Root position 7 fully diminished. BDF A flat. This is going to function a lot like a 5-6-5. So 5 chord in first inversion. 5-7 in first inversion. So this chord here is BDF A flat. Let's, instead of the A flat, let's put it in a G. BDF G. Here it is with A flat. That's a 7-7. Here it is with G, that's a 5-6-5, right? So they function in basically the same way. They're going to want to go to 1, and here you go to 1. And then just a little cadence thing. So I want to go back and have you listen to the whole thing again. So this is just Lates copying what I just said, which is that 7-7 behaves just like 5-6-5, right? It's a neighboring chord with root position tonic. 7-6-5, right, has scaled degree 2 in the bass, so it behaves just like 5-4-3. It's a passing chord between 1 and 1-6. 7-4-3 behaves just like 5-4-2. We know 5-4-2 always goes to 1-6, so it's passing chord between 5 and 1-6, or it's a neighboring chord to 1-6. And 7-4-2 is really not that common. We didn't even see it in that last excerpt. It's kind of rare, and it would just be normally a neighboring chord to root position 5-7. Let's see, I think I have that picture here. Yeah, we do. So that last point, I don't expect this to make too much sense to you, but you'll see it in just 1 second. So this illustrates the same thing that was on that last page. So first example of A. So what we were saying, this is C minor. If we just change that A flat to a G, this would be a 5-6-5 chord in C. So I'll play it first with a G and then the second time with the A flat. That's 5-6-5. And here's 7-7. And this time I'll just do both. Right? You could do either one. It kind of doesn't matter. It's just like melodic difference. So 7-7 functions the same as 5-6-5. 7-6-5 functions the same as 5-4-3. It's just a 5-7 chord with scale degree 2 in the bass. Imagine this A flat is a G, and this would give you a 5-4-3 chord. So I'll play it first the way it's written, then with a 5-4-3 instead. So first as written. And now it's 5-4-3. So that has a slightly different sound, but that's definitely functioning in the same way. Right, so 7-6-5, if you're trying to figure out how to use it, you could kind of remember 7-6-5 works as passing, but you could just say, I use it in the same way as I use 5-4-3. With 7-4-3, I do recommend remembering that this is just like a 5-4-2. 5-4-2 always goes to 1-6. So let's look at it the way it's written. And I'm just going to change this A flat to a G, and that's going to give us a 5-4-2 there instead. And this last one. So what it's saying is the 7-4-2 isn't really that much of a chord on its own. It often does this thing where that seventh of the chord, it's a B chord, B, D, F, A flat, and the A flat's in the bass, resolves down to G and just becomes a 5-7. Okay, and then at the bottom here, you have spelled out what I'm saying about how these chords are so similar. So 5-6-5 and 7-7, right? 7-7 is just like 5-6-5, and they're the same except for that one note. Here's 5-6-5. And here's 7-7. 5-4-3 is just like 7-6-5. Sorry, I did that wrong, but here's 5-4-3. Here's 7-6-5. 7-4-3 functions just like 5-4-2. Here's 5-4-2. Here's 7-4-3. 7-4-3. And then this last one, the seventh is in the bass. It doesn't really have a strong function, but that's why he puts this one in a different octave to show it. This doesn't really resolve to this. And it doesn't, they don't exactly function in the same way. Okay, so we are almost done. This is a comparison of 7-7 and 5-7. Both of them expand tonic. 7, fully diminished 7th, only really occurs in minor keys. Later, you know, next year, you'll see how you can use it as a kind of mixture chord all over the place, actually. But in just diatonic major key, there's no, you can't build a fully diminished chord. You can only build it in harmonic minor. Okay, so but the 5-7 chord comes in both major and minor keys. Seven fully diminished chords have scale degrees 7, 2, 4, and 6. Whereas if a 5-7 chord has 7, 2, 4, and 5. Okay, that's how they're similar and also how they're different. The 7-7 doesn't share any notes with the tonic, whereas the 5-7 does. I'm doing 5-6-5 there. Scale degree 5 is common between the two. Fully diminished chords are highly unstable because they have two tritones between scale degrees 7 and 4 and between scale degrees 2 and 6, whereas 5-7 chords are only kind of unstable because they have the 7-4 tritone. Okay, and last-ish is how to voice lead 7-7. This chart helps you use scale degree 6. It's going to go down to scale degree 5. Scale degree 4 tends to want to go down to 3. Scale degree 2 is sort of weak, wants to go up to 3 but could go down to 1. And scale degree 7 is the leading tone. It's going to want to go up. So the most important ones in there are scale degree 7 is the leading tone, wants to go up. Scale degree 6 is the seventh of the chord, wants to go down. Okay, and then these two could really go either way. They would rather go inward to 3, and in that case you have a doubled third, and that's perfectly okay. So let's look at these examples. So let's just check this. Scale degree 7 goes to scale degree 1. Scale degree 6 goes down to scale degree 5. Scale degree 4 goes down to scale degree 3. And scale degree 2, it could go either direction, but kind of wants to go up. So one more time. Take a look at this one. It's just we now have one scale degree 7 going to 1 in the upper voice, and in the lower voice you have passing motion. So let's check that out. I'll play just the outer voices. And the whole thing one more time. So let's just check the voice leading on this. Scale degree 7, the leading tone does go up. Scale degree 4 is the it's not the 7th of the chord, actually. It's just the 5th of the chord. Let's do this one. Scale degree 6 is the 7th, has to go down. It does. Scale degree 4 wants to go down, and it does. And then this is scale degree 2, and it could go either direction, but it continues going up. Okay. Oh, this is the last screen. So this is a chart from the end of chapter 7. But I just wanted to sort of like revisit it, and we could think about what are the new things we learned here. So the way this chart worked in the old chapter is it was showing you, it reminded you, if you were expanding 5, you can go between 5 and 5-6, and then as chordal leaps, or you can have a passing chord, 4-6 in between. With 1, you can go between 1 and 1-6, going up as passing. You can go down through arpeggiation, 1-4-6-1-6. You could even do 1-5-1-6. And then you could also go neighbor from 1-5-6 and then back to 1 again. So what we did in this chapter is we didn't flesh out anything new in here. So let's just ignore this box. Let's pay attention to just this box. We did explore some passing or some neighbor things. Let me start there. So 1-5-6-1. We can also go 1-5-6-5-1. If we're in minor, we can go 1-7, like 7-7-1. I think those are all our options. Oh, we could also do, we can be on 1-6 and we can go up to 5-4-2 and back to 1-6. Those would be our neighboring structures. And then we could do double neighbor, which is 1-5-4-3-5-6-5-1. Then for passing, this is scale degree 2 in the bass, right? We can go 1-7-6-1-6. We can go 1-5-4-3-1-6. If we're in minor, we can make this a 7-6-5. So we can go 1-7-6-5-1-6. And I think that is mostly a summary of all the things we did. So the thing I would hope that you would learn from this is you don't have to learn a whole bunch of new ideas. You sort of want to connect what we're doing in this chapter, what we did in this chapter, with the stuff from the previous chapter. And this will help you down the road. So first of all, it teaches you like the idiomatic ways of using these chords. But once we get to tonicization and modulation next semester, if you've memorized these things in the key, you know, the normal key that you're in, like the diatonic key that you're in, you can start using these things as little modulation tools as well, and tonicization tools. And you'll start recognizing them in music all the time. And if you're learning a piece, you'll start parsing the piece not by measure or by chord, but really by these like two or three chord structures. And that helps a lot. And it also just helps you appreciate music, and it helps you write it too. Okay, definitely time for me to go to bed. I hope you guys are doing well, and most likely we'll be seeing each other in this way again very soon.